Great. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Christ Central Church at home. I wish I could see you. I wish I could say it's good to see you here. But it's great to be with you. It's a serious privilege to be able to join you in your homes across this city, but not only that, across the world. Last week, we found out that good friends of our church, Giancarlo and Carla, were tuning in with us from the Dominican Republic. They sent us their WhatsApp messages of them watching our live stream, which just thrills our hearts. They were with us last year, we missed them, and now they're back with us as an online community for this season, which is just so exciting. And I was told yesterday we've got people in Germany, Spain, and Senegal all joining us today. So you're very welcome if you're already with us, if you're already on our live stream, then you're very welcome. We have, we've got our live stream chat up here on YouTube. So if you are joining us from a nation, please do say something on the chat. I'll be monitoring that during the service today. We'd love to give you a shout out and to welcome you. Also, if you are joining us wherever you are in the world or in this city, please do join us on Zoom after the service. That's a video conferencing software, and we'd love to get the chance to say hello. The details of that will be coming through on the slides at the end of the service. So there's a code for that to come and join us on Zoom and say hello. We'd love to see your faces. Great. Portsmouth has always been a strategic city that reaches out to the nations. And so please do, if you've got friends from far off places, encourage them to come and be part of our community. I've just also heard from John Martin that we've got visitors with us from Brisbane, Australia. So you're extremely welcome. Well done for tuning in. I can't work out what the time is there. Obviously, our time has just changed here. So well done for joining us. We're so excited that you're able to share in this with us. We know, don't we, that God is a merciful and gracious God. We know that God is in control in this moment. And we come to him today knowing that he is a loving Father. Knowing that his love was displayed to us by the sending of Jesus Christ to die on the cross so that we would know peace with God. But not only peace with God, that we would know and be filled with a love that casts out fear. And so this morning we are able to, in the midst of adversity, in the midst of isolation, in the midst of exhaustion, exalt our God because he is constant and he is faithful. He has poured out his love for us in the person of Jesus Christ, and that's who we come to worship this morning. So if you don't know Jesus, you've come to the right place, and we're so glad that you are here. And as I said, we'd love to connect with you. We'd love you to join us week by week as we explore what the Bible says for us today in the midst of this crisis. Just to let you know, before Lydia brings our church news, what we're doing in our service today, Simon and Natalie will be leading worship for us from their living room. So we're really excited about that. Dan Nat will be preaching in our home series. So this is our home companion guide, if you've got yours. We posted this for free online on our Facebook page. So there's a PDF copy of our home series companion guide. That's like a Bible study guide that you can work through and journey with us as a church. We've got two more weeks of this left. And so Dan will be bringing a short message from this series later. And then we've got Rosie, one of our doctors, who's going to be updating us on how she's feeling through this present crisis and how we can continue to be church and to pray in this time. And then we're going to end with a time of communion together. So just perhaps I'll post Lydia's notices online on Facebook. So if you haven't got some juice or some wine or some bread, please, you've got 2 minutes to run away and get those while Lydia brings our church news, and then I can post that up on Facebook if you've missed it. So we're going to take a time of communion, and I'm going to pray a blessing over us as a church community. Great. Paul, if we could have Lydia, that'll be wonderful. Great. Number one. If you've got kids and you joined us, hopefully you've joined in with a kids Zoom chat, and that happens at 10 a.m. every week. We don't publish that publicly, but if you are joining with us and you have children, we'd love to send you the code. You need to connect with us as a church so we know who you are, so we've seen you, so we've met you for safeguarding reasons. So do that on christcentral.church/connect, and we will be able to send you details for that Zoom video chat out. Also, please continue to let us know if you're self-isolating, you need getting any food or any medicines, because we want to be able to pray for you. You can get in touch via Facebook or directly with Lydia. So that's Lydia at christcentral.church. She spends her Tuesdays going around delivering at a safe distance for those that need help and support for us as a church. Number three, hopefully everyone is feeling well looked after in your groups. If you're not part of a group, again, go to christcentral.church/group. It's the main mechanism in which we are able to care and reach out for one another in this city. And obviously you can join from around the world now, which is really exciting. So we use Zoom or Google Hangouts to be able to facilitate a meeting where we can discuss the word, and we can pray for one another, we can share one another's burden. We're also looking to add some courses and some social events for those of you who perhaps are as I am, missing community with people. And so we're looking at perhaps even doing a dance class one evening a week, but also Duncan, one of our doctors, Duncan, is offering to run a discipleship explored class for us. So that is from the same makers as Christianity Explored, which is our gospel package that we run. And Discipleship Explored is a Bible study through the book of Philippians. And so Duncan's going to be running that on a Thursday evening. We're going to get details for you to sign up to that. Again, it will be through video chat. So we probably want to limit attendees to around 15 people. So please, if you want to join us and get to know more about the Bible, get to know more about Jesus, get to know more about the early church, and then please do sign up for that. It's going to be on a Thursday night. Finally, do like our Facebook page and subscribe to us on our YouTube channel, ensuring you click the notify bell. Just this makes sure that you won't miss a service as we are streaming.
Good morning, church. I'd just like to start with a Bible verse, and then we're going to sing a few songs together. So Psalm 18. I love you, Lord. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. For who is God but the Lord, and who is a rock except our God? The God who equipped me with strength and made my way blameless. He has made my feet like the feet of a deer and set me secure on the heights. Lord God, we praise you, Lord. We thank you that you are in control, that you are almighty God. You are all powerful. Lord, your plan sustains. You hold all things. You hold the world in your hand, God. Lord, we just praise you this morning. We look to you, God, be our rock. Let us trust you, let us depend on you. Lord God, we look to you. We know that you have the power to move mountains. You have the power to change every situation we face, God. And we praise you, we lift up your name.
Rising. To Christ Central Church. It is great to be able to gather like this. Thank you, Simon, for leading us in worship. Welcome, church. This is the second week that we're meeting like this online. Can I just extend a welcome as well if you're joining us and you're not part of the church. You've found us over the last few weeks from stuff that we've been putting out. You've been invited by a friend to come and watch what we're doing. So welcome. If perhaps you've never been to church, but you're watching this morning, you've found us because of the time that we're living in, because of everything that's happened over the last few weeks. It's so good to be able to gather together and stand sure on a firm and solid foundation. We believe as a church that as we gather together, we come to worship the one who is in control, who is over all these things that are going on in the world. We believe that God has a plan for us. We believe that he is able to redeem any situation for his glory and for our good. And it's so good to be able to, even though we can't be in the same room, even though we can't gather together in person, it's so good that we live in a day where this is possible, where we can gather together like this and be led in worship and hear God's word and pray for one another. It's been so good to see over the last week life groups meeting online. It's been so good to be able to pray and worship together on Tuesday night. It was so good to gather together as a church and do all those things. So welcome. If you are new, my name's Dan. I'm one of the elders at the church. And we are going through as a church, a series that we took a break last week for Adam to bring a message, but we're back into the series that we've been doing in the book of 1 Peter. We've been working through this book for a number of months, a few verses at a time, looking at who Peter was and what he was writing to instruct the church to do. He was writing to a church, a gathering of people that were not in their home. They were far off. He calls them strangers and exiles. He writes them and instructs them how they should live out their faith in the context that they find themselves in. How they should do church with each other, how they should live a Christian life in a land that was alien to them and their values. So we've been working our way through that book. And if you haven't heard those sermons, if you haven't been with us as we've been working through that series, can I encourage you to go to our website? You can find all previous sermons on there. And as well, you can get a hold of our companion guide for this series that we've called the series Home, because that's what we feel the church should be in this city, a home. A gathering of not just individuals, but a gathering of a family that come together to worship God, to learn about Him. So these are available now online. So you can grab a hold of these. You can join us. You can catch up on sermons that we've done in the past. And so this morning, we're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 4, and we're going to read verses 12 to 19. So that's where we're up to at the moment. So I'm going to read these verses and then we're going to get into what it says. So 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Dear friends, don't be surprised when the fiery ordeal comes among you to test you, as if something unusual were happening. Instead, rejoice as you share in the sufferings of Christ, so that you also rejoice with great joy when His glory is revealed. If you are ridiculed for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in having that name. For the time has come for judgment to begin with God's household, and if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who disobey the gospel of God? And if a righteous person is saved with difficulty, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will entrust themselves to a faithful Creator while doing what is good. I'm just going to pray for us. And then we'll start unpacking those verses. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for the fact that we have the word to go to see how we should exist as a church in this city. Father, thank you that you've shown us how we are to be with one another. You've shown us what our purpose and our outworking of what you've done in our life should be, that we should go, Lord, and we should share the gospel. We should share the good news of who Jesus is and what he's done with all who don't know him, Father. So I pray, Lord, as we hear these words, Father, for those that are watching this, Lord, would you come, would you do a work in our hearts this morning? Amen. Amen. So these verses in the context of the book that we've been looking at are following a series of chapters looking at how we should behave and act and conduct ourselves as Christians in different circumstances. So Peter's written to those who are under authority from the government, from people in power who don't necessarily believe what they believe, who aren't living for God's glory, how we should act when we're in situations like that. He's written to those who work in households where the one who rules over them isn't a Christian. And he talks about harsh masters and evil masters and how we behave and act and show that we're different in those circumstances. He's written to husbands and wives. He's written to the church as a whole about how we should go out and conduct ourselves in the world. And now what he's saying is even if you do all those things, even if you do all the things that Peter's written about up until this point, things like doing good, doing no evil, loving one another, showing mercy, serving, blessing, bringing peace, even if you do all those things, and even if all those things are outworked in the life that you live, he's saying suffering will come. He's saying there will be hard times, there will be persecution for those who consider themselves Christians when they go out into the world. He says that there's a way in which we should respond as a church when those times come. So the first point is in verse 12, he starts this portion of the letter with this. He says, "Dear friends, don't be surprised." So what he's saying to the church is we shouldn't be surprised when those times of trial and suffering and persecutions come. They shouldn't come as a surprise to us when we go in advancing the gospel into our city, into our families, with our friends, into university. That as opposition comes and we face the persecution that comes from declaring the good news of who Jesus is, that shouldn't take us by surprise. It's not an if, it's a when. Don't be surprised when those things happen. And the reason he says don't be surprised when those things happen is because he knows that the gospel that he is sending people out with is so contrary and counter to the culture that they're living in. See, for the Christians that Peter's writing to, it's a stark contrast, the life that the Christians are called to live compared to the life that they see people living around them. The values that the church should hold and uphold and live by are so different from the values of the society and the culture that they live in. And that's true for us today. That's true for us as we go and we take the gospel out, as we declare the good news of who Jesus is. The thing is that is so countercultural that we will sometimes find it hard to push through. That we'll find opposition comes against us. As we go out with the gospel, it's opposed by the world. It's opposed by the world because it stands so in contrast with what the world would say. That as we live for what is good, as we live for what is right, as we live declaring that this book is truth, as we live declaring that Jesus is the way to knowing God, that Jesus has made a way that all of us could come, that it's not based on merit or worth, that it's not based on achievement, and it's all based on grace, the pouring out of God's grace through Jesus, that because of the cross and Jesus giving himself in our place, we can come to know God. Those things are so against what this world would say is true, that we will find opposition comes against us. That's what Peter's saying. He's saying, don't be surprised when that happens. And actually, it should happen. That we should face people questioning and coming back and resistance to it, because we're in a spiritual battle. We're not battling with people, but we're battling with spiritual things that we're trying to push through in people's lives. That actually, if we are facing those things, it means we're heading in the right direction. That sometimes, actually, maybe if it's too easy for us, we're not declaring the full truth of who Jesus is and what he's done. That actually, Peter, when he writes this, is saying, no, if we're facing opposition, because we're pushing forwards, we're in a battle, we're in a war, we should face resistance. And as we push through those, we know that we have the victory in Jesus. That we don't face a battle that we think we're going to lose. We face a battle that has already been won by him and for his glory. But a battle nonetheless. And if we're facing those things, if we're living with those things, if we're finding it hard and there's resistance to it, it means we're heading the right way. Because as the world pushes back, we push advancing with the gospel, knowing that Jesus has won, that it's his victory, that it's his work, but that he's called us to take part in. So then he says not to be surprised when those things come, and then he tells us to rejoice. So verse 13 says, instead, rejoice as you share in the sufferings of Christ. So he tells us to rejoice when those things happen, when we face trials and sufferings that come to us for the advancement of the gospel. We're to rejoice. So how is it that we can rejoice in the face of those things? In the face of opposition, in the face of what this church is facing, you know, physical persecution to the advancement of the gospel, how is it that they can rejoice? Well, they don't rejoice in and of something in their own strength. Instead, Peter tells them to rejoice as you share in the sufferings of Christ. See, there's something that unifies us with who Jesus is and what he's done when we face opposition and trials. You see, Jesus, the greatest missionary, the example of what it is to live in a culture that is so counter to what you know is true, that as we look to him and advance his gospel, we share in his sufferings. He is our great example. We look at his life, a life lived in perfect unity and step with the Father's plan, and yet a life filled, and we can see the opposition that he faced. That he faced isolation, that he faced ridicule, that ultimately he faced physical punishment, and eventually he faced death on the cross. In a culture that wasn't his, he was a missionary to it. He had stepped down from heaven to come to us, to bring truth and life and love and mercy and grace to all that would hear. But he would come knowing that he would face those things. So we rejoice knowing that Jesus fully relates to what we're going through. That actually, if you're facing persecution, if you're facing trials for the advancement of the gospel, if you feel like as you take the name of Jesus to your workplace, to your family, to your friends, and you're met with ridicule or mocking, know that Jesus stands with you. Know that he fully relates to everything that you're going through because he himself went through it. We don't rejoice in isolation. We rejoice because we know we share in something of Jesus. We know we go through the same thing that he went through. He knows what it is to face hard times. He knows what it is to stand and to face the things that we face because he went through it. It says in Hebrews that we do not have a God who cannot relate or identify to us, but he says we have a God who fully sympathizes with us in our weakness, that Jesus knows how we feel, knows what we're going through, that we can rejoice knowing that even in the midst of all those things, he stands with us. He knows that we can turn to him with all of our worries and our anxieties and our pressures that we face, knowing that he can identify with us because he went through it too. And then he goes on to say, rejoice because you share in the sufferings of Christ. The second half of verse 13 says, so that you may also rejoice with great joy when his glory is revealed. He says, as we face pressures and trials and sufferings that come, he says, you need to lift your head as well. Says you need to lift your eyes out of what you're going through at the moment. In the midst of what we go through, Jesus is with us. He's for us. He knows how we feel. He listens when we pray. He strengthens us by his Spirit. He's with us in the trials. But he says also rejoice because there is something coming. There's a day coming that we can look to and find in him. Says that we rejoice with great joy when his glory is revealed. See, not only does he stand with us now, he knows that there is more to come. There's a day coming, an end coming, where we will see him in all his glory, in all his fullness. That we will see that standing for him was the thing that would reveal in us the glory that as he comes again, he has a bride, a people, a church that are for him, that are singing his praises. He says there's a day coming that the church will reveal the glory of God, that there will be a day coming where we see the throne of God. There's chapters in Revelation that are in our readings for this week that say before the throne there's a multitude, a people from every nation, tribe and tongue, too many to count, singing God's praises and glorifying him. You see, Jesus says that you need to, as well as looking to him in the midst of it, you need to look to him in the fulfillment of it. That at the end, there is a day coming where Jesus makes good everything that has happened. That actually he restores and he repays all those that have sacrificed and lost for the sake of the gospel in this life. Paul says that he counts all else as loss for the sake of knowing Jesus and being found in him. He says that anything this world has to offer is loss compared to knowing Christ. He says that he casts off all that would hinder. He throws off anything that would hold him back, and he advances the gospel with everything he has, knowing that he's running a race with a finish line. That as he crosses the line, he knows that one day he will hear Jesus say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That sacrifices made in this life, they're outweighed by the glory that is coming. That pain and suffering and struggle that we may face now is repaid more than you can count in the future that is coming. That Jesus will one day wipe every tear from every eye. That he is the one who is seated on the throne. That he is the one who there will be a crowd gathering before singing his praise and declaring his goodness and his glory. That we as the church have an eternal mission in mind. That we know we're winning people to an eternal hope. Maybe you're watching this after the last few weeks and everything that you felt was secure and solid has started to slip away. Perhaps you're watching this thinking after the last few weeks, maybe it's been something to do with your job or an income or money or family or friends or something. The thing that you were investing everything into has started to slip away and you're seeing the frailty in. The Bible says that all else is sinking sand. It's building your life on a beach, and as the tide comes in and the sand washes away, the house starts to tilt and crumble. And yet to build your life on Jesus, to build your life on the Word of God, to have this as our solid foundation, it says is like building your life on the rock. That as the waves come, as the trials and tribulations and hardships come, that actually if your foundation is the rock, then nothing can be shaken or moved. Maybe you're watching this thinking, I need to find a solid and firm foundation. Maybe you're watching this thinking, I need to reevaluate what it is that I'm building my life upon, because the thing that I thought would last forever clearly isn't. And can I encourage you to look to this? Look to the Word of God. Look to who Jesus is and what he's done. Not only is he with us in the midst of trials, not only is he with us in the midst of suffering and persecution, but he lifts our gaze, he lifts our eyes to a day that is coming where like it says in Revelation 21, he will wipe every tear. He will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant," that in him we have a promise that will last forever. That in Jesus we have an eternal hope. And this hope isn't one that we've worked for or earned or strived to achieve. This is a gift of God. This is the grace of God poured out through Jesus on the cross. That if you're thinking to yourself, but I can't come before God because of what I've done. If you only knew what was in my past, then there's no way I could approach him. There's no way God would want to give me this gift. Well, none of us earned it or deserved it. The Bible says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It says that we choose him because he first chose us. We love him as a response for him loving us. That we can come to him knowing that he has dealt with everything that would stand in our way. That he has dealt with everything that would stop us from coming into his presence. He's the one who put that to death and raised us up and now calls us to come. So if that's you, I'd encourage you to get in touch through our website. Drop us an email. We'd love to chat to you. We'd love to lead you on this journey to coming to know who Jesus is and what he's done. That in the midst of everything, in the middle of the times we live in the middle of advancing his gospel in a new way in this city, he stands with us. He identifies with us. He's with us in our weakness and our suffering. We know that he is good and he is ever present. And also he lifts our eyes because our hope in him is eternal and sure. It will never falter or fade or let us down. That even when we cling to anything else, it gradually slips away. He is the thing that we can hold on to for eternity. I'm just going to pray for us before we finish and move back into a time of worship. I'm just going to pray for us before we go. So Father, thank you, Lord, for this word. Thank you for your letter. Father, thank you for your church. Lord, I pray now that we would see the frailty of what this world has to offer. That actually ultimate security isn't found in money or jobs or houses or anything that we could hold on to. Father, I thank you that eternal security is found in who you are. Lord, I thank you, Jesus, that you are the thing that will last forever. Lord, we want to glorify you. Thank you that you stand with us in the midst of what we're going through. And thank you that you lift our eyes to a day when you will be seen by the church as the one seated and sovereign on the throne forever. Lord, I thank you that you are in control. We worship and we glorify you. Amen. Amen.
Hey guys, thank you, Dan. Thank you so much for that amazing message of grace and an encouragement to all to come to know the gracious love of God for us in this season. It's available to all, as Daniel said. Nothing in your past can prevent you from receiving the love of Christ and the peace of Christ in this time of a trial, in this time of suffering, in this time of persecution. We're shortly going to be taking communion together, because as we stand in Christ in this moment, we also stand together. And it's important, as we're connected as a core community, as we're connected as a church community now across the nations, that we know that we stand together in Christ. We stand together on a sure and firm foundation. And to enable us to take communion and also to be aware of the struggles and the trials that are happening within our community, I've asked one of our doctors to give us a quick update about how they are finding the current times and how we can stand with our doctors and pray for them and the National Health Service as we move into some of the harder times of the coronavirus outbreak. Now, you'll be aware that Boris Johnson wrote a letter, I think, last night just to say, which hopefully isn't a surprise to us, that things are going to get worse still. And we need to be prepared for that, church. Things are going to get worse still, but that is why we stand on a strong foundation. That is where we find our hope. This is where we be still and know that God is exalted in the nations. In the midst of a worsening situation, we can still cling to the rock. So, Rosie, we should have a video lined up.
Hi everyone, I've just finished a night shift in the intensive care unit. It's been an emotionally difficult couple of weeks. Things are just changing so quickly that you feel like you're just about getting to being adjusted to that, and then suddenly the goalposts are just changing. One thing I'm really thankful for is the Christian medics and healthcare workers that we have in our church and also in the hospital as a whole. And in this time of isolation, I feel like we are and we can be a household. There's so much to kind of unpack in that concept, but I just ask that you would pray into that, pray for friendships to be deepened, pray that we would love each other and that we would love our colleagues, and that that would overspill into our friendships and relationships with colleagues at this time. I think my overwhelming emotion at the moment is grief. There's a lot of human pain and suffering at the moment across the world, already within our own hospital, and also an anticipation of what is to come and the difficult times ahead. This is a really merciless illness, and I think we just really need to pray to our merciful God, for ourselves and for this nation and the world at this time. I've been reflecting a little bit on how Jesus would be reacting to COVID-19, and I think that he would also be feeling grief for the world and would be understanding of the pain and the suffering that it's causing. Acutely at the moment, I'm really feeling the tragedy of not having any visitors in the hospital at all. And, you know, please let us know if any of your relatives are admitted. We'd love to be able to support you in some way. I think I'm processing more emotions now than I ever have done, and I pray that it will bring us to our knees over the coming weeks and months, and that we would be depending more and more on Jesus. I pray that in hospital we would have the peace of God, which we know surpasses all understanding. And also please pray that we would have supernatural power and strength to do our jobs better than we ever imagined would be possible, and that we would be able to bless people and bring healing and care to them at this time. I feel reminded of the hymn, O Church Arise, which goes on to say, O Church Arise and put your armour on, hear the call of Christ our Captain. And I think that time is now. You know, situations like this are throughout the Bible, and I pray that we would learn from that. And I love that the rainbow has become the symbol of hope in this time across our land. So thank you for your prayers, they're very much appreciated.
Amazing. Thanks, Rosie. Now is the time, O church, arise. As we rest in God, as we find ourselves hidden in God in this time, we can be bold, share the love of Christ to this city, to the nations, to those around us at this time. We stand together as the household of God. And now we're going to move into a time of communion. And the Apostle Paul speaks of communion in 1 Corinthians 10, and he says, the cup of blessing that we bless, is this not a participation in the body of Christ, in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, and we who are many, dispersed around the city and the world, we are one body in Christ, for we partake in the one bread. So if you've still got some bread and wine before you, I've got mine in a handy container here. These are available if you're in self-isolation. Would love to get communion out to you. Why don't you reach for those as I just read the words of 1 Corinthians 11 and lead us through together, making this statement of remembrance for what Christ has done for us. And then I'm going to finish with a blessing over the people of God from Numbers. With me. First of all, we take the bread. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your bread and your body and your blood that unite us as a church family this morning, with whatever griefs we are carrying, with whatever worries we are bringing to you, whatever fears we are trusting in you to overcome with your love. We stand together and we can rejoice in knowing that through Christ Jesus we have life and we have hope and we have a future. We're going to close our service with a song. It's called The Blessing, and it takes its lyrics from the priestly prayer. This is the Lord speaking to Moses in Numbers chapter 6 verse 23. Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Now we too have been grafted into the same promise as those of the Israelites. We too are the church of God, the people of God. Those who have come to profess faith in Christ have been grafted in to the purposes and the promises of God. So this blessing applies to us wherever we are listening to this service. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you, Christ Central Church, and be gracious to you. May the Lord look with favor on you and give you peace. Heavenly Father, I pray for that blessing right now for each and every one of us, no matter what storms are raging in our hearts right now, no matter what sickness we are battling, no matter what circumstances we are bearing, Lord, that you would show your gracious hand in our lives. Lord, we know that you've poured out all things through Jesus Christ, that every promise in him is yes and amen. And now we pray that blessing on ourselves as your people in this city, Lord, that we would go out and do your work, be your church, share your love, and know your peace. In Jesus' name, amen. We're now going to play a song. If circumstances allow it, please do continue to listen, reflect in this song, hear the words over you. Our God is for us. Let it be so.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children.
May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, church. Our gracious, almighty, powerful, ever-loving, all-sufficient God is with you right now in the midst of your circumstance. If you'd like prayer or support for anything that is happening in your life right now, we want to stand with you in that way too. And shortly we'll have some slides up with our phone line and our email line. Please do get in touch. We also have a video conference now on Zoom. That's a meet and greet. Again, if you are new to us, please come and be part of that community. The ID will be again on the screen shortly. Also, if you are joining us from another country or you're new to us within the city, please do connect with us. You can do that on via our website, christcentral.church/connect. If you'd like to be part of our midweek groups and sign up for Discipleship Explored, the details of that are available on christcentral.church/groups. And if you're used to giving as part of your worship when you're with us on a Sunday morning in person, you can actually now give online, so you can find that also on our website at christcentral.church/give. If you are visiting us, please know that God does not need your money, so feel absolutely no obligation to give. We'll be putting the video of the notices on our YouTube page, but also just as an encouragement as we leave, to share a bit of family news. Again, we'll perhaps post the picture if we can, but there was a new birth in our church family this week. And you may have missed that if the audio cut out, but baby Lily was born to Taiwo and Stacey. So they already have a girl called Shola. Baby Lily is a baby girl that was born on Monday at 12:40, and mother and baby are fine, and they're at home, and they're receiving support from their family there. So that's super exciting in the midst of some difficult circumstances. New life has come. So if you know Taiwo and Stacey, please do reach out to them and give them a great congratulations for that wonderful news. For us as a family. Great, I'm going to close in prayer and hopefully see you on our Zoom chat soon. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace to us as a community. We thank you for this powerful moment of togetherness this morning. Lord, we pray you would embolden us and equip us by your Spirit to reach out to others, Lord, that they would know the strength of this community, Lord, that they would know the joy of being connected to church, Lord, but most of all, that they would know the joy of knowing you, of receiving your love and your peace. So do, Father, give us opportunity this week to share your love, even in the midst of lockdown. Lord, that we would be reaching out to those less fortunate, Lord, than ourselves, and to those that do not know you, Lord, and we would be bringing the peace and the love of the Almighty God. In Jesus' name, amen. Great. Thanks, church. See you soon, or I'll see you on Facebook or on YouTube throughout the week. Take care and God bless.